What we have here is a presentation where our goal is to discuss the issues of what we have in the office. Now, the topics we're going to be discussing: fibromyalgia. We're going to be talking about migraines. We're going to be talking about the effects of what happens to an individual. Now, I typically get patients that come into my office with a lot of discomfort. I deal with chronic pain management. I deal with acute injuries. Our goal is to understand where the basics of how to begin the treatment protocols for individuals with chronic pain. Chronic pain is not a disorder of let's say, issues. It's issues of not treatment properly. It's a perpetual disorder that continues, and it just kind of lives on. Now, we have to get to the basics of what the chronic inflammation is. For that, we have the science of inflammology. We have the science of understanding. We have laboratory assessments from all sorts. And what we're going to do today is we're going to present the issues. Now, a patient typically comes in and discussing, "Doc, my body hurts. Everything hurts, from my hair to my back. I'm depressed. I'm socially disconnected. I'm having issues with my husband because, and typically it's more often with fibromyalgia, more women than it is men. Statistically, that stands as well. So as I have these present, but by no means it does not affect men. And when it does affect them in a brutal way. So as we deal with fibromyalgia, we have to look at the concomitant issues. What we're going to be discussing today is the issues of fibromyalgia, even migraine issues, because not everybody that has migraines has fibromyalgia, but many people who have fibromyalgia have, you know, disorders of what we call of pain, and in essence, the presentations of the issues that actually cause the discomfort in individuals. So as you can see here, we are at a different type of presentation today. We're actually presenting from our office, and what we want to do is we want to be able to discuss those particular issues that affect each and individual one of you that have fibromyalgia. Now, in terms of this, we have a panel here, okay, and our panel is ultimately going to discuss those issues. So let's go ahead and present Kenna Levon. Kenna Levon, go ahead.
Yes. Hi, I'm Kenna, and I am the senior health coach for the office. And with fibromyalgia, I'm going to be talking about genetics and laboratory work, some supplements, as well as body composition today.
Excellent. And we also have our master nutritionist, which is Ana Paola Rodriguez Arciniega, who comes, and we're all online at this point, and she's going to be discussing certain issues. So, Ana, why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself there?
Hello, my name is Ana Paola Rodriguez Arciniega. I'm a nutritionist, and I will talk about the dietary interventions that can help the people with fibromyalgia, and how can it provide a better understanding and a better treatment for the nutritional issues that comes with the diagnosis or with the syndrome or with the condition.
You know, as we discuss those particular issues, what I like to do is I like to present the dynamics of the stories of what we have. So when I have the patients present to us, they actually draw patient diagrams. When I have a fibromyalgia patient, not only do we have psychological issues or depressive issues as undertones, but we have pain all over the body. Clinically diagnosed, you know, fibromyalgia has been so easily diagnosed or diagnosable by the new standards, as well as the chronic pain management institutes throughout the United States, that only 5 points and pretty much of pain in certain areas, and pretty much you can be classified as fibromyalgia. The typical treatment is through symptomatological treatment protocols, such as if you have pain, well, analgesics of some sort, whether powerful, you know, all the way to corticosteroids, as well as some anti-inflammatories. So analgesic anti-inflammatories. Now, if the individual has issues where it starts affecting, you know, anxiety issues, stress issues, well, sometimes is, you know, for many common times is an SSRI, which is kind of like a Prozac or the derivatives of that to alleviate the symptoms to work with that. So again, we're not treating the actual issues. What we're going to go here is we're going to start opening the conversation to discuss the dynamics from that we've learned and that science presents, that we have been able to pinpoint inflammation at the level of the brain, inflammation at the level of the gut, inflammation of the brain and the spine. When we say inflammation of the brain, we need to understand the brain is composed of an area inside, obviously, the brain cavern. But as it extends down beyond the foramen magnum, it's called the spinal cord. But it's still the brain connection. So it affects even at the spinal cord area through disorders called central sensitization. We're going to discuss those here. And we're going to figure out what are some simple ways to treat, along with some nutritional protocols that we can come up with. So what I'd like to start today is with Kenna, giving us a little bit of background as to what these individuals are suffering and what is the definition today based on what fibromyalgia is known to be known for. Okay, so go ahead, Kenna. Go ahead and tell us a little bit about the story of that. Now, as she develops this presentation, we're going to go back and forth and try to, you know, make it make sense. Now, I want to add that what we want to do is we want to give you take home, you know, nuggets, so to speak, to be able to make this better. But we're going to go deep into the DNA and the genomics of this because we have to understand who is susceptible to fibromyalgia. And for that, Ken is going to do some explaining right now. So go ahead.
Yes. So the first part we want to talk about is, of course, the genetics. We are constantly finding out more about our genes and how they can actually be influenced by environmental factors as well as the food that we're eating. So the first genes that I want to take a look at are the ones that you can see up on the screen. And I also put the study down below if anybody wants to go further in and look at it. It's a super great study and I highly recommend it. So we can see that genetic factors are possibly responsible for up to 50% of disease. Susceptibility, which is a huge amount if you think about it. So I'm going to break down each one of these genes just a little bit. And so that first one we see is SLC64A4. And this is for an encoded protein that has a transmembrane protein of that inner mitochondria. And the mitochondria is often referred to as the powerhouse of the cell. So mitochondria is super, super important in our body. And it's required for homeostasis. And just like many other SLC genes, it has also been linked to other inflammatory diseases such as rheumatoid arthritis. Most people who come in with fibromyalgia aren't just suffering from fibromyalgia, as Dr. Jimenez was saying earlier. They're also suffering from other things that can be linked to inflammatory processes like migraines. And there's a lot more too. That second gene that we look at is the TRPV2. And this gene encodes for an ion channel that is activated by high temperatures above 52 degrees Celsius. And the protein that is involved in this one is responsible for our sensory ganglia. So that one, as well as other tissues,
sensory ganglion, so you know, it's where where we perceive, but it is an area where all the nerves synapse. They come together to synapse at a certain point. So they all get together, and the area is typically called a ganglia in that region. So the synaptic cleft of those nerves is very important. That it also adds to understanding a little bit about fibromyalgia, specifically to central sensitizations, which we'll discuss in a few moments. Go ahead.
Yes, thank you, Dr. Jimenez. The next gene is the MYT1L, and this is a member of the zinc superfamily, and it is responsible for expression as well as neural tissues. So this has a lot to do with fibromyalgia, as we were saying earlier, how it comes into play with the brain and the central nervous system. And with this gene in combination with other transcription factors, it can actually convert fibroblasts and neuronal cells. So this gene is super important to look at when we are considering fibromyalgia with our patients. And the last one we're going to take a look at today is the NRXN3. And this one also encodes for the nervous system and adhesion molecules. And this one is a promoter of the transcript variants and protein isoforms for the gene. And the full length nature of these variants have not yet been determined, but we can link it back, like I said, to the nervous system.
I'd like to present the fact that, look, you're not going crazy. People may believe that after they suffer fibromyalgia, that people don't understand them. They look at them like there's no way you can suffer this way. However, today with nutrigenomics, nutrigenetics, and DNA assessing, we can actually find out if we have single nucleic polymorphisms, which is a simple word of SNPs that are out there that make you susceptible to this. So Kenna is very well versed on understanding and interpreting these particular DNAs. As we run these labs through DNA Life or 3X genes, different companies that for different particular genetic coding encodings to understand what are the nutritional supplementations or what can we do to adapt. Now, what we want you to understand is that we need to have the depth of knowing that there is an ability to change the genomic expression. Now, the genes are, just to give you a practical sense, we all have genes. We all have a pair from our parents and our pair for equal mom and dad, and it goes on from lineage from our ancestries. But these presentations do not have to be activated all the time. So I call it, in essence, the gene is the gun, and your lifestyle changes, and what you eat and what you do is the trigger that fires these genes. So when we look at these, we here have a philosophy from the genes to the kitchen, kind of nomenclature, or a little bit of a descriptive word, that we understand what kind of things we can do nutritionally that we can change the genes, because we're not going to go ahead and change and edit the genes, obviously. But however, what we were going to do is we're going to do nutritionally what can make the genes work in a better way. And I don't want to get into the dogma of saying that we eat a certain way, we take a certain drug, and we change the genetic expression. That's not what we want to do. But we want to understand that we have the ability to assist our body in its dynamics with its environment. So I hope that makes sense, because we got to bring this thing into understanding that it is a very new world, but we are learning enormous amount of information daily. As this information comes in, we're going to be able to assess what your predispositions are. And if you do have these predispositions, well, then we need to work with your lifestyle changes, your foods, your nutrition. When it comes down to it, nutrition is everything. Even in bodybuilding, all bodybuilders know that you can look all pretty, but without the right nutrition, you're still going to be bony. So we have to understand that nutritional components is very, very at key to understanding. So once now the world opens up into the chasm of understanding how the chromosomes work in a much more dynamic way, and again, this is a very it's evolving quickly around the world, and we're able to run these tests. So let me ask you this, Kenna. In terms of our testing that you particularly do, tell me a little bit about what kind of tests you like running, what companies do you use, or what kind of dynamic patterns do you look for specifically for those particular assessing an individual's predisposition to, let's say, fibromyalgia undertones?
Correct. So we use a ton of different labs. We work with so many, the very best. And I've just put together a little snippet so we can see these ones first here. That first one that we are talking about is DNA Life. They actually have a whole entire collection of DNA testing that we can run. The more that we run, the more we really understand what we're dealing with on the inside of the body and how we can help to express those genes in a positive way rather than letting them express in a way that we don't want them to. So it just kind of lets us see, like you were saying, what they are predisposed to. Those tests that they have include DNA Health, DNA Mind. Those two are super huge. DNA Diet. This one also comes into play when we're trying to figure out with our nutritionalist what foods are going to be really great for them in that kitchen to impact their genes the most. They also offer DNA Skin, DNA Estrogen, DNA Smile, and Grow Baby. Another one that I really love to run on the patients is from Vibrant Wellness, and it is the Neural Zoomer Plus. And this test actually has genetic testing that comes down to show their risks for certain neurological conditions. And so when we're dealing with fibromyalgia, we also want to take a look, as we were saying, at that brain and the inflammation and everything that goes into it. The other one that I really like to pair with those other two tests are going to be from Vibrant America, and it's a connective tissue panel. This one is a panel of 48 well-studied neurological antibodies, and it's able to help us create a treatment protocol that pinpoints the mechanisms behind that disease and the progression, as well as kind of provides us with a good roadmap and solutions. That way we're not just shooting in the dark. We have so much more information to compile along with your detailed history, and we can look for those associated markers.
One of the things that I had mentioned there earlier was that not only can we assess the predispositions of the genomic presentation, but we can also see what type of diets are more favorable to your genomic expression. You know, genotype is really looking at the genes. Phenotype is how it expresses. So our phenotypic expression is wildly different in individuals. You would assume that in a genetic composition of two identical twins, you would have the same genetic coding through that, and you do. However, you can see that an individual who is brought up differently in a different environment, and you take two twins that, and you separate them from, let's say, at birth, you'll see that by the time they hit 70, they may not look like each other. So environment plays an important role in dynamic changes. So we do have the ability to change the expression based on environmentals as well as nutritional components. So I know, Kenna, you got some nutritional presentation there that I want to go ahead and show. Let's talk about how we can start giving people a little bit understanding of how this affects fibromyalgia, specifically the types of supplements and the types of supplements, because these aren't all the exact ones, but we review a lot of different subsets of supplements. So tell us a little bit about that.
Yes. So of course, the supplements that you will be taking, it depends on your lab work, your DNA. They're all personalized to you. This is just kind of an overview snapshot of the supplements that have been shown to help fibromyalgia patients. It is from Dr. Alex Vasquez. He's incredible. He's extremely smart and talented. And so he works with this company called Biotics, who we also work with in our clinic. And so these are just kind of the basic ones that he recommends to start out. We have a Pro Multi Plus, which is going to be just a multivitamin. It's going to give us our vitamin A, our vitamin C, D, E, K, the Bs, biotin, N-acetylcysteine, CoQ10. It's really going to just pack a punch in that small pill that we're going to be getting every single day to help our systems work better. The next one that you see is called Pro Multi Plus. This one is a mineral supplement, and it provides the body with antioxidant activity and the micronutrients that are effective and stable, while also providing phytonutrient support. And what that does is it really helps us absorb everything that we're taking in. That way, nothing is going to waste, and our cells, we're really feeding them. We're giving them everything they need to function. The next one that you see there is BioDemulsion, and this one is a vitamin D3. It is 400 IUs per drop, and it just also helps aid in the uptake of everything, as well as being important for that musculoskeletal health, as well as cardiovascular health too. And the next one right there we see is that B12. This one has more of the B vitamins, the B5s, B6s, B12, and also contains a high level of folate that's used in many chemical systems throughout the body. The next one that we have is the optimal EFAs. These ones are going to be a balance of our omegas. So we're going to get that omega-3, that omega-6 and 9, all the fatty acids that we need from the highest quality fish and flaxseed, as well as other oils. And each capsule provides optimal ratios of ALA, EPA, DHA, and it really helps find those imbalances, because a lot of us don't have enough healthy fats in our system. So it really helps us complete that circle that our body needs. And then the last one that we have right there is ADP. And this one delivers just standardized oil of oregano, and it helps us with our digestive tract where it functions the best, and it helps us in those intestinal organs.
Keep that up there, Kenna. I want to go ahead and elaborate a little bit about those. What we're noticing is that when we supply or have the right amount of nutrients, or if we experience deficiencies in certain areas, the body starts not functioning properly. These particular products that we have here, not to particularly point towards these, but these types of products, once we understand the human genomic expression and the and we'd run labs as well to see what's actually going on, real complex labs that can actually tell us today what we could not find out, let's say, I'd say 5 years ago. When we run these assessments, we actually determine what kind of mineral imbalances, what kind of supplements that you have deficiencies, what kind of fatty acids you have. We ultimately have learned a lot about supplements such as vitamin D and its implications to inflammation. It is beyond the scope of this presentation to go on there, but I can tell you that the studies are powerful and they're coming in every day. You may have noticed that even vitamin D has had its own show with the present COVID presentations. So the vitamin B complex, the way that the effect is we focus on areas in fibromyalgia that affect not only the neurological implications, but also the effects on the mitochondria. We end up looking at the mitochondria as a source of any time we have energy issues. So coenzyme A, cofactors, CoQ10, which is a product we can never go wrong by giving CoQ10 specifically for metabolic issues pertaining to the mitochondria. So we learn about these things as we go. We understand the, you know, essential fatty acids, how using those particular, you know, fat products or fat producing, energy producing products or essential fatty acids makes the difference. So ADP has always been a product that is well been known for its effect on the mitochondria as well as areas on dysbiosis. Now, I didn't touch much on dysbiosis, but we have to understand that many of the people that have fibromyalgia all have intestinal, not all, but they have many suffer from intestinal dysbiosis. Now, what we understand about intestinal dysbiosis is that when it goes awry and we have what we call gram-negative bugs, we have lipoprotein lipases that are formed or exudates or products from these bacteria that somehow leak into the system that cause inflammation. So our whole basis of this whole process is to stop inflammation and get our mitochondria to function better. So many, many studies on this, and we're going to elaborate as we go through this. So what I'd like to do is pause on that particular subject matter and now discuss a little bit with Ana Paola, who is our nutritionist, who actually evaluates those things. So Ana, go ahead and see if you can log in and get your camera ready and your posting ready and your video presentation so that I can go ahead and start presenting that. Because we have to understand, Ana brings things home in terms of the logics of it. So and how to make it simple to understand how we can make dietary changes affect a person with fibromyalgia. Now, again, the person has come in with extreme pain, depression, sadness, irritability, a lot of things that happen as a result of discomfort or chronic pain syndromes, but they have sickness syndrome. So they're depressed, they're sad, they don't want to go nowhere, they're in pain. So we need to be able to say, okay, well, maybe we don't understand the genetic genome, but what are the things we can do in terms of dietary changes that will ultimately adapt and fix these musculoskeletal presenting disorders. So take it away. Go ahead, Mrs. Ana Paola.
Hello. Well, first of all, one thing that I've noticed about the fibromyalgia patients is that they always come to a nutritionist as the last part of the treatment. And maybe that's like the way it should be done, because they are very interested at the very beginning. They are very interested in losing all of the pain symptoms. That is like the most important thing for them. But once they start getting like into their heads and being aware of everything that is going on with them, they start like getting into the, okay, I'm feeling bad. I have this bloated abdomen. I am feeling really bad, so I must take care of it. So that's something that I've always seen in these patients. They are concerned first about the pain, and then they start noticing another kind of stuff. So after all, this condition is multifaceted and it has a lot of factors. So one of the principal factors in which I can participate in is that, first of all, we have to put food first. So yes, supplementation is a very essential part of the treatment of fibromyalgia, but ultimately The things that you do in your kitchen are the ones that are going to produce the main changes and to provide the habits that you need to keep those symptoms at bay. So the first thing that I have to recommend is that you take nutrition as the first line or the first strategy to lower those symptoms. And another thing, maybe this is one of the things that we are going to be doing, like in the back part of your treatment, is that nutritional treatment has to deal with the low-grade inflammation that is going on in the body. That is one of the main factors of fibromyalgia. There's a lot of inflammation, and we have to lower that. Another thing is that the pro-oxidative status needs to be lower as well. And this is like the thing that we have to use supplementation for this, because sometimes while you're trying to be a nutritionist and keep the, well, most of the people think that nutritionists are here just to like lose some weight or that kind of thing. And yes, that's one of our main focus, but
Anna, just to kind of jump in there a little bit, when you mentioned something about oxidative load, what we're trying to do is we're trying to lower the overall oxidative load on the individual. And that's what you're discussing. Maybe the reactive oxygen species, the level in the body is too high oxidative state. So our goal through dietary changes is to change and influence that. Is that what you're mentioning? Yes.
Yes, eventually. And while you're trying to treat the pro-oxidative state, you need to lower the inflammatory state as well. So this can be like treated in the same way with the same nutritional aspects. So right now, the first thing that I need to add is that dietary approaches are mainly focused in lowering this kind of overlapping symptoms that come with fibromyalgia. And that's why they are like so varied. And there are a lot of studies that show that nutrition can help, but there is like not enough like sufficient and very well done studies in this. So this is like the first thing that I like to say, that one of the main dietary approaches that are used in studies that is used in fibromyalgia is the low FODMAP diet. I don't know if you ever heard of that, Dr. Jimenez.
Absolutely.
Yes. Okay. That is like the first one that is like a very important dietary approach. The another one is the gluten-free diet, hypocaloric diet, the vegetarian diet as well, and of course a lot of nutritional components like extra virgin olive oil, omega-3 fatty acids, curcumin or turmeric. But one thing that I would like to focus right here is that, as you see in the outcome measures, there are a lot of questionnaires right there, and that really has to do with the fact that most of the people with fibromyalgia come with a very low quality of life. They want to go out, they want to eat, they want to have fun, they want to move, and they can't. So obviously, the emotional part, the kind of like subjective part of this condition is very important, and that plays a main role with the dietary approaches. So most of the results are
Can
kind
I
of
go? Can I
very.
interject there? Let me ask you this. In terms of when you individually look at these individuals, tell me what you see in their life qualities in terms of how it's affected them. Because I think that if the more people who understand this, more couples who understand that their spouses are going through this, or maybe both are going through this, we can kind of open the conversation as to the approaches nutritionally that we can make. What is it that you see these individuals kind of show in their lives? Tell me a little bit about how you discover how they feel. Go ahead.
The first thing they see is maybe a little bit overweight, but they can actually they focus a little bit more in the bloating. I think that is like the first thing that they come to see me for. It's like I am bloated, my face hurts, my hands hurt, everything hurts. So the bloating, I think that's like the main thing, and that's why I tend to go a little bit more with the low fat diet. That is like the main approach I tend to use. And yeah, definitely that is like something in their quality of life that is affecting them. Just like the fact that you're bloated after, I don't know, your 3 o'clock meal and you just can't go out afterwards, that really annoys them. So I think that is like the main thing that I can see. But a lot of the studies have focused on the fact that they are not happy with their body composition. They just don't feel happy with that. And that is actually linked to the depression factor of this condition. So
Now, I want to kind of, because you've mentioned that a couple of times in terms of the body weight dynamics. I'm going to ask Kenna if she can talk a little bit about how we assess, because you're correct. As we look at these individuals, we see that they look bloated. So we know now that there's a what we call an anthropometric measurable change in their body. So when it comes to anthropometrics, what we look at, and we'll wait for her to queue up, what we see is that there are issues that affect the individual. So when we look at those particular dynamics, we want to look and see how anthropometric measures are done within the office. Now, because we now have technology that wasn't available, let's say 10 years ago, we can actually see the type of inflammation, the type of swelling, the type of muscle mass. Actually, inflammatory markers can be assessed through anthropometric measures. So, right off the bat, we are in a much better layer of understanding in present modern technology of what actually goes. Got it. And then what we can do is we focus on the in-body. Our ability is to assess that. Can you zone in on the first page of the in-body report there? Kenna? Good. Yes, right there, what we're seeing there is the ability for us to determine how much muscle mass, how much weight, how much inflammatory dynamics are going on in the body. It seems kind of complex, and we'll go over this. Can you take me to the second page where we actually show on our initial report, along with the anthropometric measurements of body mass, but we also look at things such as weight of water and how much water the body has. Now, one of the things that we're very much keen to look at is we look at visceral fat. And visceral fat has the tendency to produce its own hormones and cause a different array of changes within the body. So that inflammatory state causes haywire with hormones. It disrupts estrogen. It disrupts insulin. It causes us to be insulin resistant. All these things make us feel bloated, of which Anna was discussing. So Anna, why don't you go ahead and cue yourself up for the conversation here? I want to talk about specifically how you look at that inflammatory dynamics and those changes. So if you can get yourself on the screen there, I can go ahead and show exactly what's going on. Now, from my practical point of view, when we have these inflammatory dynamics, we have to put a team together. We have to figure out not only what your predispositions are, what your labs are, what your blood work does, but we also have to kind of come up with a team approach, because it does not bode well when one particular type of doctor tries to handle this multifaceted, multi-organ system dynamics that's called fibromyalgia. It affects many things from the brain to the gut to the synapses to the ability to deal with pain. Abnormal sensations. I mean, this is real crazy, but the disorder causes so much pain that actually touch turns into sharp pain, burning. So it really, really does adapt that. So if we can get to the diet component and understand through anthropometric measurements that you do have these issues, well, we can start guiding you better and formulating a diet plan that is most effective for you. So Anna, go ahead and tell us a little bit about what's going on there.
Well, that's true. And that is something that has a lot to do with dropping some weight and intervening with this anti-inflammatory diet. So one of the things that that intervening with diet have brought to the fibromyalgia studies is that it can actually lower the weight of the patients. And with this, we are particularly speaking about lowering the amount of fat mass that your body has. particularly in the visceral area, the visceral fat. That's precisely what is going to affect, and that is bringing benefits to this treatment. And the main reason why is because adipose tissue can actually release pro-inflammatory cytokines, and that's exactly what you want to do with an anti-inflammatory diet, to reduce that kind of pro-inflammatory milieu that is going on with people that have a high percentage of body fat. So that is,
you know, you mentioned that on as you do that, we're understanding that the world of inflammation, specifically when it comes down to the dynamics of cytokine, that's it's a word that's made its name in the public, cytokine storm, specifically the COVID. People that have a high BMI, they are more pro-inflammatory. So that even affects the dynamics of fibromyalgia. I am positive that we're going to find out that people who suffer from fibromyalgia or in a chronic state of severe pain and suffer from the COVID infection may find studies that actually affect their ability to respond and to recover from that cytokine storm that Anna is reflecting. Continue to tell us a little bit more about the diet. Go ahead.
Well, that is actually true. And something funny that I found about reading a little bit more about the dietary interventions is that they don't focus a lot on the weight loss, even though most people are concerned about that. The main concern about the dietary interventions is to provide anti-inflammatory relief. So that is something very important that you're telling here right now. So I think the one of the most important anti-inflammatory agents that has been proposed for the treatment in fibromyalgia is turmeric or curcumin, what we kind of know about. Well, we can use it like interchangeably, that kind of name. So this is actually an inhibitor of all of the pro-inflammatory pathways, starting from the cyclooxygenase 2 pathway all the way from the NF-kappa-beta pathway. So this is something very important, and it has to do a lot with anti-inflammatory agent, and at the same way, it can act as an analgesic. It has an analgesic potential. So this is very important, because when turmeric inhibits those pathways, it can eventually affect the synthesis of prostaglandins, and eventually that would affect one thing that Kenna was mentioning, that was the TRPV2, I think that was the one that she mentioned.
Correct, yes.
So right here we have like a family member of that same code, and it is actually going to lower the pain stimuli from the body. So that is actually one thing that you need right here. Another thing that you can actually, well, that is actually very helpful in the anti-inflammatory process and the dietary approach of treating fibromyalgia is, of course, omega-3 fatty acids. And we must say that omega-3 fatty acids, EPA and the HCA, are very important anti-inflammatory agents, but in the same way, they are very important antioxidant players right here. So an additional thing that you have to know is that they actually can diminish the excitatory pulses that people might get from an excess of glutamate from their diet. So actually, I think that with diet, the main thing that you have to do is that you have to mix and match a lot of antioxidants, a lot of anti-inflammatory agents in order for it to work. But as you say, the most important thing about diet is that it has to be practical. One thing, and with this, with the combination and all of the mix and match thing that I just mentioned, is that, for example, Some of the excitatory processes that go on with fibromyalgia has a lot to do with the excess glutamate that is going inside the brain through the, well, because there's a permeability in the blood-brain barrier. So this is very important. Once the glutamate levels go like a little bit higher in the brain, it would affect, and the pain stimuli will be a little bit more like you
Excessive?
can feel a lot of more, yes,
Yes.
excessive.
You
You can
know,
feel
I'd like
more
to touch
pain
on
with
that
that.
subject matter because one of the things that we've learned is that glutamate is a very powerful neurotransmitter and we need it.
Yeah.
However, what we're talking about here is when it goes awry, when there's too much, when we
Yes.
have our microglia cells mandating through their activity through the astrocytes, which produce the neurotransmitter, and it just goes awry, and it's too much. It's super sensitive. It becomes dynamically part of that central sensitization. It's not that it's incorrect to have it; it's that too much of it is. So the
Too much will
load,
affect.
yes, the load is high. So curcumin has a history of being able to decrease inflammation. So do the omega fatty acids. So continue. So I love that because what we need to understand is that. What we're getting at, and I think what we're trying to express is that it's a multifaceted treatment protocol where you
Yes.
can't just
You
throw
don't.
a pill at it and just go, we got to work at it, and we have to have a team that follows you through the dynamics. So go ahead.
Yes, sure. So maybe we're talking about the inclusion of supplementation and about the inclusion of some like species like curcumin that you might like to add to your diet. But in fact, a big part of the dietary approach to the fibromyalgia symptoms is to diminish some kind of some other type of foods. And for example, MSG, you might heard about it in Chinese food, there's a lot of MSG, or maybe, well, actually in Mexican food, there's a lot of
Yeah,
MSG.
be whole.
The little, yeah, of course. The little, like tubes that we use to pick up the flavor from our like chicken soups or anything, they have a lot of MSG. And the thing about MSG is that it has glutamate. So you might like to stay away from MSG. And it's actually really simple. Just add more onions and carrots and celery to your soup, and you can stay away from that cube of consommé, that's how we call it. So that would be like an easy way to stay away from the MSG from your diet. Another thing is that the same way that glutamate in excess can affect patients with fibromyalgia, aspartate can do the same thing. And well, glutamate and aspartate are both amino acids. So with this thing, or what I'm trying to say is that you might want to stay away from the aspartate sweeteners, and that's like the way that you can provide a little bit of more relief to these patients. Another thing is that the sweeteners that contain aspartate might be linked to the IBS symptoms that most of these patients have. So, I mean, there's like a lot of clues right there about the things that you might want to stay away from your diet and the ones you want to include to your diet. And they can actually work both ways. You can take some things away and you can add them just to keep them with the flavor in your diet. You don't have to eat like a
Anna, when you mention that, the first thing it conjures up, this is going to be hard. However, it's not. Today, with modern technology, what we have is the ability to kind of help individuals through modern day. Just take pictures of your food and we can help you. So, by monitoring these food dynamics as we see what actually you eat, we can make additional recommendations. The thing that we need to get in this process is that fibromyalgia is, since it's so multifaceted, it does not have an answer, and very few times do you have the first sure shot at the bullet to treat it. However, we throw what we can at it and we adapt. We adapt the changes. As we d make those changes, you need a team member and someone to discuss that with. So how hard is that to monitor? Well, it's kind of complex if I have to write it down each time, everything I write, everything I eat. Today, modern technology makes it where, which, as you can see, I have my phone with me at all times. And what you certainly can do is take a picture and have a team member that understands exactly what's going on. For that, we have Kenna and our nutritionist, which is Ana Paola, who can actually help you adapt to those changes, because that's very critical. Wherever you go, you got to go to a doctor who's got a good nutritionist or someone that can sit with you and understand exactly what it is you're eating, because that is what triggers these disorders. And if we can start working through that, we can start lowering the inflammatory load, so to speak, the oxidative state. We can help the mitochondria. We can help the biomes in your intestines restore back to normal, and that helps us in that process. So I know that you were talking a little bit about grains, and there's been a lot in the public about grains. Tell us what you're talking about specifically about these ancient grains.
I think that this actually has to do a lot about the a lot with the fact that each patient has to be tested the right way. And I mean, as you said before, don't be dogmatic. Don't just stay away from the grains just because you have fibromyalgia. No, get tested. Be aware of your symptoms. Get to know your body. Maybe you just don't have this overlapping symptom of bloating that comes after gluten or maybe gluten-based foods. So that's like a disclaimer. You have to be very aware of your own symptoms before just taking all away from your diet. And in this case, this particular case, as you might see, gluten-free diet has been part of the dietary approaches of fibromyalgia, but it's because of the overlapping symptoms within IBS and celiac disease or non-celiac disease. So you have to be very aware of your symptoms and what you are eating, first of all, instead of just taking all out. So I'm going to talk specifically about this ancient grain product that is called Khorasan. And maybe Khorasan is just a word that was previously used to describe Afghanistan. I'm pretty sure that's like the word. But they have seen that it has a lot of micronutrients and macroelements. It actually has a lot of fiber. It has like the 56% that we need on a daily dose. So that is amazing. It actually has a lot of magnesium, phosphorus, potassium, selenium, and zinc. And as Kenna mentioned, we can determine the amount of zinc and magnesium that you might need or that you might be missing. But in previous studies in fibromyalgia patients, they have shown to be very deficient in this kind of microelements. So this Khorasan wheat can actually be used as regular wheat product, like, let's say, bread or anything. But it showed some improvements. So maybe this could be like an extra inclusion to your diet instead of just like taking the wheat out of your diet. You can bring back the Khorasan wheat, you can eat Khorasan products, and you can have a better response to your fibromyalgia symptoms. So it actually showed some improvement right here. But I think that you have to be aware, first of all, and make sure that you have Khorasan products around in your local market, because that is actually like the way you want to make it like possible for the patients to introduce this to your diet. So yes.
In terms of other dietary changes, what kind of other dietary changes in general are a good approach?
A good approach? Well, actually, I was very amazed at the intervention with different lactobacillus was not really like very important in this kind of patient. That was something I was really amazed, because it is clearly that the microbiome has something to do with the symptoms and fibromyalgia, but it did have some impact in the way that people make like rapid responses, like when they feel like overwhelmed and they take like very bad decisions. That was like the main thing that they actually were helpful with. So eventually it has to do something with fibromyalgia and depression. But actually Mediterranean diet or the intervention with Mediterranean diet and the supplementation of tryptophan and magnesium was the one that had the most like effectiveness in this kind of condition. So yes, this could be something that could be added to, or you can introduce to your diet a lot of foods that are mentioned in the Mediterranean diet. But yes, that was like the most impactful diet approach that could be used, and it actually lowered the weight of some patients, and it was related to the with lower concentration of pro-inflammatory cytokines. So that's something that you want to have around when you're dealing with fibromyalgia.
I noticed that you have a big title up there, psychological and sleep effects. It appears that sleep is critical in understanding even like COVID, the treatments and the susceptibility, but it's also important in fibromyalgic patients. What is it that you notice about the sleep's importance in terms of individuals with fibromyalgia?
The sleep importance. Well, it increases the quality of life in the patient. It is actually one part of the questionnaires about the quality of life in every kind of application or clinical application. So yes, it is very important. And actually, there have been some few studies reported about the melatonin use in fibromyalgia, and they had positive results, but they had no like association with the pain score. So maybe they weren't that important because, as I said before, the patients with fibromyalgia want to keep the pain at bay. So that was the thing that I was able to find about melatonin and about sleep, but that is very important in this
Do
kind
you
of
know I want to digress and I want to get Ken involved in this particular part of the discussion in terms of lifestyle changes, Ken, in terms of things that we can look at in terms of lifestyle dynamics. Maybe you want to get your computer up there and see if that we can actually kind of come up with ways that we have been able to address the lifestyle changes that are so important in an individual with fibromyalgia. For me, it's critical. Sleep is critical. You'll notice that the individual who has the sleep patterns can adapt. Maybe not so much the pain receptor issue is diminished. However, their ability to sustain just the barrage of kind of the dramas associated with this. And when we deal with sleep, we're also, as you can see, we're talking about inflammation. And at the base of inflammation is immunology. Immunology has its basis on its ability to recover. And for that, sleep is critical to be able to reset the body in order to sustain those blasts, whatever they may be. Tell me a little bit about this, Kenna, in terms of what you look at when you look at lifestyle changes. And also, I want to also, if you wish, Anna, you can chime in on that particular subject matter.
So sleep, as you have mentioned before, is how our body repairs itself. It's crucial for everything. Our brain needs the rest, our cells. And when we sleep, we take all that good food that we've eaten throughout the day and we really burn it and digest it. And so that's why it's important to also make sure, like Anna was saying, you're eating the right foods to fuel your body so that when you sleep, it really is restorative. It really does help heal the body. And one way that we can help improve sleep in patients can be as simple as adding in meditation to your day. A lot of fibromyalgia patients do have chronic pain, and so exercise might not quite be there yet when we first start. But one thing that we can do is add in just mindfulness of what we're eating, what we're doing, and then adding that meditation, even as simple as 5 to 10 minutes, has been shown to help relax the body, and it can reduce inflammation throughout the day. It's just, meditation can be such a powerful thing, as well as grounding. Grounding is something that you do when you're barefoot. You go outside and you just let your body and your feet, you feel the ground. You take deep breaths, you let all of it come in. It might sound silly, but it has been proven to help. And when you just take even small lifestyle changes like that, because we're not going to go crazy at first. They have to be maintainable. It has to be something that our patients are able to do. So just by taking those two things, for example, we can start to see such positive impacts. And once we get onto those lifestyle changes, we can start maybe switching other ones, such as, you know, the soaps they're using, the shampoos they're using, the fragrances in their home, adding some plants to their house. Snake plants, you only have to water them once every 8 weeks. You know? I have two toddlers mine alive. Yeah. So, you know, just adding simple things like that can really, really start to change our genetics and the way that we are and our sleep. And it just, it's incredible. The small lifestyle changes we can make to improve sleep as well as symptoms.
I know we're going to get in a little bit of a more complex of these issues. In terms of Anna, you know, in terms of lifestyle changes, what have you noted that the patients do in your experience? Specifically lifestyle changes, because I want to digress, and before we end, I want them to understand a little bit of lifestyle changes and things that, like yoga, Pilates, Tai Chi, things of spirituality that make an important component in the recovery process of a fibromyalgic patient. What have you seen, Anna?
Well, the first thing I've seen is that gratefulness is one of the main things that can actually help people to process what they are feeling. So when you have this kind of chronic situation, when you're constantly feeling pain, you are aware of that pain, and maybe you just shut down all of the amazing things that you are going through or the things that are going around in your life. And one thing that I really like about, well, that I link to nutrition and that I link to food and everything, is the fact that you have to be very aware of what you're eating. So every time you sit down and eat, just turn off the TV and just really take the time and take your turn to fully chew your food and think about, I don't know, probably I have right here this chicken curry recipe. Oh, I'm not sharing my screen, I'm sorry. So even when you're thinking about eating, you need to go through everything that went to that process. So when you're, well, this is
that looks good, by the way.
Oh, thank you. This is something that my mom tells me, like, don't you ever feel angry about being able to cook, because you have food in your home. So that is very important. Once you go through the process of getting treatment in every kind of condition, and you bring the food back from your nutritional program, and you have to be thankful that you're able to provide that food to your body. And that eventually will bring some kind of healing to the process.
Now, so one of the things that you mentioned there, just if I may, you talk about making the food, the understanding, and you should not feel bad about making the food. How do you feel? How do you personally feel when you can be able to create your own dynamics in your foods? Because I feel that just the creation of the food and making it happen serves also as a kind of a release of dynamic expression.
It's an appreciation, because you are able to move, you're able to cook, you're able to convert something that was uncooked to something that was cooked. Maybe that's very simple, but it will ultimately will lead to better functioning of your body. So I think that first you have to go through that explanation about everything that is going into your dishes and how it's going to provide an extra help to your condition. So I feel that once the patients go and start making their food, they are able to fully digest or process that way of thinking. and they can actually perceive the nutritional function of your food a little bit better. So yes, that is very important, just the fact that you know that food is medicine and that food should always come first.
Any other ideas in terms of we are going to be touching on this matter in a much more intense way because I think it's important. We will probably spend the next month or so discussing fibromyalgia and the dynamics, and we'll be tweezing out these supplements and sometimes going down the rabbit hole of, let's say, N-acetylcysteine or even the vitamin D complex issues. That will be in its own podcast and its own presentation because it is very highly complex and there are many studies for it. We can't assume that everyone knows the implications of NAC or homocysteine's effect on inflammatory states. We have to understand that it is a complex dynamics, that it requires a team of individuals that actually understand the process of trying to work with a recovery regimen. There's no pill. There's no sure shot. There is a dynamic cacophony of things that we can do to change the lifestyle of an individual. I know that, Anna, you also did some work in terms of in the dietary changes, but tell us a little bit more about the direction you wanted to take this particular podcast in.
Oh, this particular podcast, then I really wanted to take it into the way that, as Kenna said, mindfulness and awareness. I think that is like the first thing that you have to take care, that you have to see as yourself as a patient. You have to be aware of everything that you're feeling and everything that is going through for you to be able to go to the doctor's office or to the nutritionist's office and tell them exactly what it is that you are feeling, or maybe not exactly, just tell them how you're feeling. And that will provide a very much in-depth treatment for yourself, because if you just come in with a diagnosis such as fibromyalgia, which is very extensive, man, then what am I gonna do with that? You have to be very aware of what you are feeling and what you want to do. Ask about what you want to do and what are your, well, maybe if you'd already did some kind of research, you can go through that and say what you want to be treated as. So yes, that could be something. And there is actually a lot of things that could be done when you're talking about the nutritional aspects of fibromyalgia, and even the vegetarian diet could be one, the gluten-free diet could be one approach, the FODMAP diet could be one approach, or even an elimination diet. I think that the main role of the nutritionist while you're speaking with a fibromyalgia patient is to leverage and to negotiate the treatment, because most of the people, they want to first to stay in their comfort zone, and you have to meet them halfway at the beginning, and then they're gonna start moving along with you. So yes, the approaches are many, and that's the way it should be. You just can't take this one approach and go with it for the rest of your life. You have to listen to the patient, and you have to listen to the symptoms as they revolve, or as they dissolve, or as they continue. So I think that
as you notice there, one of the things that you mentioned as a nutritionist, your approach, the health coach also becomes a important contributor in managing the care of a fibromyalgic patient from the types of exercises we do. Many times that we look at this dynamics and we assess it, understanding what the doctor's role is, what is the nutritionist role, what is the dietitian's role, what is the health coach role, what is the physical fitness individual that is important in the recovery, for how much stretching, how much exercise is allowable. The individual that kind of connects the dots in those is usually the health coach. Kenna, tell us a little bit about how that integration between the fitness nutritionist, the dynamics of treatment, and from assessing the issues comes together for you as a health coach, if you may.
Yes. So as you're saying, everything works together. The body is so delicate. And so it's really important that we do find that balance and that we have...
Anna, stop sharing your screen just for a second there. Stop sharing. There, go ahead. There you go.
And so when you incorporate everything, what I take a look at, you know, these in-body results that we have with this inflammation. And we also work with a gym called Push. And so we really take everything and create a whole personal program, and we connect with the patients. If the patients have questions about the stretching that they should be doing or just anything in general, they can always reach out to us. We have apps available. They can message us on this InBody app, or they can message us on an app called Coach Care that we work with. And we can even set up video consultations. Just one of my roles here is to make sure that our patients always feel seen and heard, and that we're listening to everything that they're saying. And so anything that they have, we just really wrap them around us and take care of every single need, whether it's what drink they should get at Starbucks that won't flare up their inflammation, all the way down to what foods they should be eating or exercising or stretching, or really just anything. We are the team for you to help, and my job is connecting you with the doctor and with the nutritionist to make sure that we are getting those right answers for you in a reasonable amount of time, and that you're not just waiting.
Going from just the fibromyalgia dynamics to the present issues, we can clearly see that the care of a person suffering from, let's say, concomitant migraines with fibromyalgia is very complex. Some that just have fibromyalgia, this inflammatory state at the level, the deep to the mitochondria, has to be weaned out all the way to the history. We see that the story is important. We do complex history assessing to determine exactly where this thing began. Where are the clues? What are the, we call, antecedents, triggers, and mediators of these particular issues? So in terms of what are the causes before this happened, what are the mediators, what are the things that continue this process and keep on feeding the fire of inflammation? One of the problems that we do in medicine is sometimes we don't get the answer right up front, and sometimes the deep histories have to be done in an in-depth way. So, and time is incredibly it's important, but you can't always get the information right away. So as time progresses, our job is to unpeel the complex onion of an individual and figure out what are the causes, what are the things, and also understanding that we can go reaching deep through lifestyle changes and change quite a bit. Sometimes it's just a small tweak. Sometimes it requires a little bit more than a small tweak. So our team here is designed to be empathetic, understanding, compassionate, and passionate about what we do. So our goal is to understand, to clinically evaluate, and to come up with the known standards of what treatment protocols that are out there, and come up with the best approach for each individual. I hope that this has been a bit of useful information for you guys, and we're going to present much more elaborate. And as we get better and our team gets more dynamic as we do these presentations, we're going to do more and more so that you can understand the complexities of issues like fibromyalgia. They're not so simple. And as time goes on, we realize that the magnitude of a disorder that has one diagnosis code affects not only the brain, the effect, the psychosocial, the emotionals, the anxiety, the depression. It affects everything, and it does make individuals feel sick, and what I call sickness syndrome. So when they just feel disconnected, and things happened as a result of that. So it's a very important thing, and though it may seem to start as a musculoskeletal disorder, the implications go far, and also the implications are dynamic and changing. So not only when you say, aha, I figured it out, eureka, it moves, and we have to adapt with an individual's lifestyle and their changes. So I thank you again, and we look forward to hooking up with all you guys again. So God bless, and we're here as a team. So thank you, Kennelly Vaughn and Ana Paola Rodriguez Arciniega. Thank you so much, guys. You guys have an awesome day, okay? And I'll chit-chat with you next week, and we'll be here next week. Thanks, man.